Wake up, everybody, no more sleeping in bed. No more back thinking, time for thinking ahead. The world has changed so very much from what it used to be. There's so much hatred, war and poverty. Oh, 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 oh. Wake up.
My name is O.W. Sweeney, and I want to welcome you to your favorite TV show, You Got to Laugh to Keep from Crying. And I'm here with my illustrious co-host, brother, comrade, and friend.
Yes.
Mr. Richard Courts.
Yes, sir.
All right, then. How you feel?
Oliver Wendell, my brother.
All right, all
right. Good to see you, as always.
All right, then.
And it's great to be on the show with you.
Well, look here, I just want to get there. You know, I like that. I like to get the folks that...
Oh, yeah.
Our best friend.
I know.
You know,
yeah.
We got to get them in here.
They're our sponsor.
Who's our sponsor?
It's North Carolina
Triad
Jobs with Justice. And they can be reached at
336-272-2758. All right, now.
We've done that.
We've done that. Yes, yes, yes. You know, I like to get them in.
I know you do. And you're absolutely right about it, too.
So, a very good organization. So.
Yes, sir. And who do we have as our guest this evening?
Professor Michael Roberto.
PhD.
PhD.
And now we're going to call him Michael because we know him.
Hey, well.
Right?
Well, we got to give him his
just
due.
Absolutely. He got that degree.
Bring him in.
And he's got that license to teach young people, and that's a good thing.
And he don't let that stuff go to his head. He's still Michael.
Okay. So, anyway.
Well, I'm delighted to be here.
Welcome to our show.
I'm delighted to be here. Yeah. Thank you.
Right. And you want me to?
Go ahead.
Okay.
Honor, look here. Let him know what we're all about.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. Michael, this is our highest award. It's our Workers Deserve Respect button. And we know from having read your articles in the News and Record in the past, from having seen you in demonstrations for justice and all, and having talked to you, that you believe, as we do, that workers deserve respect. And so we're very pleased to give you this button, which we actually, the two of us together, designed about 20-something years ago.
Thank you.
Around the post office. So.
Well, and we always say wear it with pride, because the workers are the majority in this world.
And they're the ones that make everything go round.
I will wear it proudly, and I thank you. I will make sure that I have it on when I teach tomorrow.
Oh, great.
That'll be wonderful.
You know, we are faculty at A&T, but we are workers. And some of us have to keep reminding others that that's basically what we are.
Right. It's a lot of people think just because you got that doctor on your name that you employ yourself. But you are employed by somebody else.
Yeah. Right. Absolutely.
So, and you say North Carolina A&T, a place that I love, but I still say those institutional higher education is one of the biggest companies in the United States. Mm-hmm. Because I don't think they slant people's mind to be respectful to themselves or for other workers.
Let me just say this to you. You can't be too far wrong, because Bowles, who was the that's the guy who was the unsuccessful rich man candidate for the Democratic Party twice in a row for the U.S. Senate in the state of North Carolina. Erskine Bowles, who was appointed by none other than President Barack Obama to head the Bowles-Simpson Commission with former Republican Senator Simpson of Wyoming. It was all about how to take the money away from the people, how to put the austerity of this economic crisis that we're going to talk to with Michael, Dr. Roberto, how to put it on the backs of the working people. And Bowles is the guy who ended up being appointed as the head of the UNC system.
Right. Well, and you know, with respect to the UNC system too, it's, we are experiencing all of these budget cuts in education, in higher education, and this is having a very harmful effect on universities. and to be asked to continue to do more and more
for less
makes somebody with a PhD no different from anyone who works on the line in any manufacturing plant. We're basically all in the same boat here.
Okay.
We're just different kinds of workers. So that said, this is an honor, and I will be wearing it often.
Good. So we want to get to the subject at hand, which is what's going on with the United States. How do you place the current crisis that working people face in a historical perspective?
Well, ever since 2008, the majority of the people in this country have experienced severe hardships. Mm-hmm. Loss of jobs, loss of homes, loss of families. I mean, this crisis, which began in 2008 and supposedly ended when the Great Recession ended,
yeah,
has not ended. And
right,
this recovery...
Well, it ended for Wall Street.
Well, of course.
Wall Street's done tremendously well since.
Well, of course. And it usually does end for Wall Street. I mean, even when you look at the Depression in the 30s,
mm-hmm,
that the New Deal kept millions of people from a worse plight,
mm-hmm,
but the people who recovered quickly was big business. Big
right.
business recovered quickly until the Roosevelt administration decided in 1937 to give the reins back to big
Wall
business.
Street.
And
mm-hmm,
what happened was a recession in 37 that put 2 million people out of work almost immediately, and brought conditions that were, if not as bad as 1932, the year before the New Deal, were very, very bad. And so there's a lesson to
and
be learned.
World
there.
War II was the
yeah.
was and, what actually and, we had,
yeah, yeah, and then pull and then it was
out.
It's clear
yeah.
it's clear that I mean any serious economist today will tell you, any serious historian will tell you today, that it wasn't the New Deal that pulled America out of the Depression. It was the war. It was wartime production.
Sending
right.
those
and
working
mass
people
mobilization.
Over there to fight for their, for
right.
their capitalistic ideas, because a lot of people don't understand that after World War II ended, a lot of those German scientists was brought to the United States.
Yeah. So anyway, the crisis today is profound, and despite all of the trumpeting every now and then of signs of recovery, there
they
is...
They call them green shoots.
Yeah, right. I mean, it's a recovery for the few,
right,
and as opposed to a recovery for the majority.
Are you saying that trickle-down theory don't work?
Yeah, I would be inclined to say that for sure. Yeah, I think it's a preposterous myth. And this is what I try to teach my students as an historian, as students who are taking history courses in contemporary world history, contemporary U.S. history. They really need to understand how to distinguish between myth and reality. And the myth here is that no matter how much you give the people at the top, they are not going to provide what is necessary at the bottom. And the result is that the middle now is falling apart. It was interesting. There was an article in the New York Times on Sunday about how even companies in America today have decided that they can't make as much money as they used to by making commodities that are aimed at middle-class people. Now it's commodities at the high end or commodities at the low end. Now, we've been saying this stuff for quite a long time, but when the business community recognizes this, then you know that they're involved in they're part of a trajectory that really has no solution to it. In other words, they're going to keep doing this And so what they do is a reflection of the widening gap between wealth and poverty in America. And it's profound.
Right. And one of the things that, in the list of things that you mentioned, which I thought was a good list, but one thing that you left out of that list was that even among the millions of working people, the people that, so many of those people lost a decent paying job with some decent benefits and ended up, when they went back to work in this crisis,
right,
they went back at a much lower wage with much less benefits for themselves and their families.
Well, of course. And
so the immiseration or the impoverishment, even among the even when you look at the percentage that are working,
right,
the amount of poverty of the working poor, as O.W. pointed out recently to me, the emphasis on that concept of the working poor. The working poor are becoming, you know, an overwhelming majority of the population very quickly.
Right. And also tied to this is when we hear that the manufacturing sectors are recovering, right? Build an auto plant in South Carolina. Build an auto plant in North Carolina. Create good-paying jobs. What's a good-paying job? $13.50 an hour.
Yeah, which is not
what does that translate to? About $30,000 a year?
Right.
Well, that's fine if that may be fine if you're a single person, or barely fine. But can we honestly say that a manufacturing recovery that brings jobs that pay $13.50 an hour that used to pay what, $28? $30, $35 an hour,
right,
that this constitutes a move, a decisive recovery where people are going to move into the middle class, and people are going to move from deprivation to slightly better than deprivation.
The illusion.
Yeah.
And it's very well documented that people think the country is doing well because you look at the news and they talk about how great Wall Street is doing.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wall Street is doing fabulous. But yet, how many people out there got them part-time jobs?
Right.
Paying, I give them $9.50. Got to work two or three of them.
Right.
And have a family.
Yeah, and that's very very disturbing, because what's not really being counted now, and what is almost impossible to count, is underemployment. You can count underemployment with also with the proviso that you recognize that, as we all have in the last few months, the unemployment rate is going down, but that's because people have stopped looking for work.
Right.
So you can build that into your understanding of what real unemployment figures are, but you can't really do anything when it comes to underemployment, because how do we measure that? How would we even begin to measure how many millions of people in this country are working two, possibly three jobs?
I got the answer to that. 4-hour workday and living wage.
Yeah, well, that.
my thoughts are pure and simple. The 8-hour workday is obsolete now. There's too many companies employing people for 4 hours at such a low wage that they got to get two and three of those jobs to support their family.
Yeah.
Why not pay those people a living wage so they can spend more time with their family at less work hours? And with the less work hours, you can employ more people. It's better from what I understand about the economy is that the more people that are working, the more money they change hands, the better the economy is for all.
But that's if this were a democracy.
Right.
But since
it is a hypocrisy.
Yeah, but that's not a democracy.
I understand, brother.
So the fact of the matter is, if maximum profit were not the driving force in the society, then what you said makes sense.
I understand.
But since maximum profit is what drives this economy, and the capitalists in Wall Street are dominating this economy, they're not going to allow us to do that.
Well, no.
And that's why they won't even. That's why the living wage is going bye-bye right now.
Well, then it is a crisis. It's a crisis of profitability. I mean, if capital is all about the need for constant accumulation, then that means that profit margins are always dynamic. They're never fixed. And I think what's amazing in these times is that in order to maintain levels of profitability, that large companies, corporations, I mean, people who have capital and control capital, now recognize that they just can't, pull profitability, increase profitability from increasing productivity from machines. Now, in addition to that, you also have to squeeze the workers even more. So in other words, I'm not an economist, I'm an historian, but to the extent that I understand it, this means that corporate America, for the most part, is bent on squeezing the American worker for as much time as he and she can offer, because time is everything and man is nothing here. That's what we call absolute surplus value, the extension of the working day. In other words, beyond what you can get from a machine and what a worker does on a machine, what more can you get from the worker himself? And I think that is what's profoundly disturbing about this crisis.
Well, you raised a couple of points that with me, and one of them is that the capitalists in this country are now so ruthless, and this is maybe where your friends, the North Carolina Republicans, fit into this.
You call them our friends again. We might be a fight right on the show.
if we weren't such good friends, I never would have said that. But anyway, what they're doing is an example of what you're talking about, because what they're really doing in this state is they're taking away the minimal rights that workers in this state had. And they're actually providing a basis for the capitalists to take from the future. I mean, because in general, capitalism has to allow the workers to reproduce.
Right.
So there'll be new workers for the next generation.
Right.
And now this system is so desperate, and I'm with you on this, that I think that they're actually reaching into the future to take away from the future, and they're robbing that future.
But the future for them. Unlike in past crises, even the 1930s, the future now is even much more questionable for them, because the nature of this crisis is such is that not only are human beings being undermined, but the very basis of nature itself, nature is being undermined. I mean, and this is, we have to understand ecological problems, we have to understand that this is not only an economic crisis,
right.
This is an ecological crisis, right. And the end game here is not only to rob the worker of all of his value and his dignity, but also to undermine the natural basis upon which everything functions.
But that also fits in with what you were saying before. This is the desperation of capital in this last dying stage, that they're also robbing the earth of its future.
Right.
I mean,
right.
At the same time.
And so their window. So I guess my point is that their future is a much more narrow future, a much more limited future than it was 70 years ago or 80 years ago. We are living on borrowed time.
And one thing I like to say, a lot of people don't realize it, but this year taking away teachers' tenures is just to oppress people. And it's basically is oppress the teachers, is trying to collapse the educational system of the state, because most of those teachers are going to go somewhere else.
Right. I agree.
To get a job.
I agree.
And what they're trying to do is to privatize the public schools.
Yeah.
And the more they legislate, the worse education gets.
Right.
So if they would stop trying to legislate education, I can't say do what they do best, because all they do is mess up. So I have to find another word to put it in. Right. To do something constructive to help the people. The 1% of the people, not the 99%.
Last spring, I got into a bit of trouble on my campus because the president of the system came to A&T, just so happened on the day that the faculty senate was meeting, and he came to talk about the strategic plan that had been developed. And when the strategic plan came out, it was passed around to the various campuses, and faculty were asked to comment on it. So, like every other campus in the system, some A&T faculty quickly pulled together their comments, and we sent the comments forward. All right, mm-hmm. And the day that the president came, he got up and in front of us, he said, "Well, now that we've finalized the strategic plan, it's time to implement it." And of course, some of us looked at each other, and we said, "What do you mean? We're not finished discussing the strategic plan." So we brought that up to him, and I raised my hand and I brought it up to him, and I said, "I suggested that this needed more discussion." And he asked me for an example, and I can't remember exactly how it came down, but one of the things that we wrote in our critique coming out of A&T was basically took the form of a question. Is this a strategic plan for higher education in North Carolina, or is it a strategic plan for how higher education can support big business in North Carolina?
Right.
And he was visibly upset. And,
must have touched on a truthful nerve.
Remember that old statement, the two hurts?
Yeah, and unfortunately, I didn't have the report with me that day because he asked me for proof. And of course, and anybody who'd read the report knew that it was
right there. Yeah.
And so, I mean, what do we have here?
And let me just give you one example that fits in not only the privatization of education.
Right.
Both OW and I were postal union leaders at the local level here, and we're still both active enough that we're trying to help save the public postal service. This is another area where capital is desperately seeking to find new areas to get profit, and they're privatizing everything in sight, and it doesn't matter to them. This is a public service that costs the people of the United States nothing except when they use it.
Well,
it's my understanding
too that the post office has even been prevented from utilizing its own resources.
That's true.
Is that correct?
Yeah, that is true.
Yeah.
And so that's another example. But I think all of these privatization examples, whether it's education, and of course, this is the only modern capitalist society or advanced capitalist society that doesn't have some form of single payer health care, universal health plan, and the bitter war on the Affordable Care Act has some substance in the main, the Affordable Care Act itself is an accommodation to the big pharmaceutical industry, the big hospital industry, the healthcare. They're not touching it. They're guaranteeing it's a health insurance plan rather than a health plan for the United States. But it has enough for the people that the main rulers were ready to create all kinds of havoc around just even those few things for the people. But I think all of these show the desperation of capital
in this
time.
And I guess, I mean, we could talk about these big issues and how they're affecting the country, how people are being affected nationally, but I mean, my primary concern right now, I guess, my focus is what do we do about it here? How do we respond?
Okay, and we have only a couple of minutes. This has been good.
Yeah,
so why don't you?
We're going to answer that question.
No, but go ahead. No. Wait a minute. Let's let him. Tell our audience that we're sponsored by North Carolina
Triad Jobs with Justice. Yeah.
And
well,
they
can reach us at 336-272-2758.
And now we can clear the deck. We can clear the deck for Dr. Roberto.
Well, that's a hard one to follow.
I mean,
I've lived in this city since 1980, I came of age in this city. I came here thinking I knew a lot about the world, and I didn't really know as much about history as I did until I arrived here, and I started to put my understanding of history in the broadest terms into some kind of context that grew out of a growing local perspective, right? So here we are in 2014. Officially, the poverty rate in the city is 20%, but we know that if you measure poverty by federal standards, where the poverty line for a family of four is what, $23,400, somewhere around that, which means that if you're a family of four and you have a household income of $26,000 a year, that means that you're not living in poverty. Well, when the median household income in East Greensboro, according to the 2011 census, was 22,000 something or other,
right,
that means a vast number of our citizens are living in poverty even below the federal guidelines, which in and of themselves are absurd. Okay,
right.
How do we deal with this? We have to, I think, recognize that there's no help coming from the top. The federal government is not going to help us because the federal government is not in a position to help us. Corporate America is in a position to help, but they're unwilling to help for all the reasons that we discussed today. So we're going to have to try to find a way to embark on a new path. And that new path means creating jobs, creating businesses, but most importantly, creating a capital formation on the basis of cooperative ownership, community ownership, in ways in which we will begin to solve the problems indigenously, as opposed to waiting from the outside.
Thanks so much for being on. I wish we had more time. We will get you back.
We're going to have to have you back.
Yeah.
Well, thank you. It's a pleasure.
Yeah. And as always,
good brother.
Yes, sir.
336-272-2758. That's right.
We'll never forget.
Triad Job for Justice. Yes. Nothing to lose but our change in a world to win.
Fresh out of school, you're looking for some work, it's McDonald's time. You're 30 years on the job, get you a place on the unemployment line. Where you